Welcome to part 3 of this tutorial series on MIDI programming in C#. Last time, we've got as far as being able to play sound on the connected MIDI instrument, both by using the keys on the computer keyboard and, in a roundabout way, by playing the keys of the piano or synthesizer. I said that this second possibility opens the door for us to make modification to the sound on the fly, so to speak, and decide what will be heard at the end. But before we get into that, there is one basic feature we need to address, and it is the selection of voices on the instrument. Digital pianos and synthesizers come with a range of sounds, and our program should be able to display a list of the available sounds, let the user select from that list, and set the sound on the instrument programmatically. So that is what we are going to do today. Open the project we created last time. If you haven't done this before, you can find the previous tutorials on my YouTube channel. I'll first show you what the interface will look like. It is very simple, but of course you can make it as fancy as you like. We can select a channel. Normally there are 16 MIDI channels, and here the sounds are organized into sound sets and categories. On your instrument, the range of sounds and their organization could be different. User guides that come with an instrument usually have a section on the available sounds or voices and tell you how to select them on the instrument. That information is often not sufficient for our purposes. For instance, the user manual for the Roland FP-30 has this much info on the available sounds. It has the names of the sounds, but what is lacking are the MIDI codes. For that, you need to go to the MIDI implementation manual. Luckily, Roland has published an extensive MIDI implementation manual for the FP-30. I might add that for the FP-30X, which is a somewhat modified, more recent version of the FP-30, does not come with a MIDI implementation manual, and many of the formerly available features have been disabled. Now, in the tone list, you'll also find the MIDI codes to use to select the sound on the instrument, the PC, MSB, and LSB. I don't know if you can see this clearly on the video, but the tone list is not very long. So, how come I have so many other sounds on my program's user interface? Well, there are a couple of reasons for this. One is that I figured out by experimenting that the FP-30 actually implements the sound sets of the FP-60 and the FP-7 as well. And as you can see, these sound sets are quite a bit larger. So even though one can't access those sounds from the piano's dashboard and therefore cannot play them, it is possible to select them via MIDI with a suitable program, such as this one I'm writing now. The other two sound sets I have here are the GM2 and Roland's version of the GM sound set they call GS. The GM sound set is a standardized set of sounds and codes dating back to the early days of the MIDI specification. It tried to be all-encompassing, including rock, jazz, folk, and classical music instruments, percussion instruments, and even environmental sounds, and weird sounds like ice rain and goblins. A classic MIDI instrument would have the GM sounds built in, even if the manufacturers don't say it. but as in the Roland FP-30's case, they are there for the clever MIDI programmer. Before we return to the discussion of the application, let's take another quick look at the MIDI implementation document. It tells us what MIDI messages the instrument is able to receive and respond to. And the MIDI messages it sends. So far, we only worked with two of these, the note on and note off messages. Today, we'll add to our arsenal the bank select codes. These are the MSB and LSB numbers you saw earlier. MSB stands for most significant byte and LSB least significant byte. And the program change or PC code. The bulk of the user interface with the four drop-down list boxes is implemented as a user control in my program, and I call it channel. I did this because later on, as my program grows, I will add several more of these controls to my user interface. In XAML, it looks much like a window, except at the top level you have user control instead of window. The individual controls on it have the usual properties, including the event handlers for when a selection is made. In the code behind, here is my channel class, with three fields. Device is a reference variable to the MIDI output device, and I will need this when I want to send the MIDI command which will set the sound on the device. I covered the MIDI out device class in previous videos, so I won't spend time on that. The channel is the currently selected channel number. The other particulars of the sound are encapsulated in a struct called sound. When an object of this class is instantiated, the controls are created, but the list boxes are not yet filled with data. That is an important little detail, because as we will see soon, when the list boxes are populated, a cascade of events fires, at the end of which a message is being sent to the device. However, at this point, the device variable is still null, so an error would occur. The device property is set in the initialization method, which must be called just after the object is created. Here, the channels list box is populated, and the sound sets list box is also populated. That is done with an assignment to the item source property. When the selected index is set to the first item in the list, it fires the selection changed event. So this event handler gets called. Here the categories list box is filled with data, and when the selected index is set to 0, another event fires, which is caught by the categories selection changed event handler. I think you can see the pattern here. Finally, when we get to the sounds selection changed event handler, the sound object is converted into a MIDI message and sent to the device. Okay, I skipped over a few details that I'm going to cover now. Up here, you might wonder why I set the selected index to -1. The thing is that if it happened to be already 0 up here, then this statement here would be ineffective, and an event would not be fired. I created a class called SoundDB, which, as the name suggests, is a database for all the sounds. I'm using the word DB or database loosely. It is actually implemented as an XML file I added to my project as a resource. So here in resources, I've got this file and it looks like this. It's got sound sets, categories, and the sound details within categories. By the way, if you are working in the same project environment as I do, that is in WPF and C#, when you add a resource to your project, don't do it in the project properties. Not here. But simply copy it to your project folder and then select the build action on it to resource. None is the default, but set it to resource, and this way it will be compiled into your executable. Here in the SoundDB class, everything here is declared static. I am using LinkU to extract various details from the file. However, you might want to implement your SoundDB entirely differently, and that's fine. The MIDI Sound Message class is a subclass of MIDI Message, which declares an abstract send method to be implemented in the subclasses. This class hierarchy will be massively extended in future tutorials. The actual MIDI message is created in the pack function. It includes the program change number, sometimes called patch number, and the two components of the sound bank number. You'll notice that when I change channels, the sound selection display does not update. I won't bother saving the sound selection for each channel because I am thinking about a different implementation for this in the future. That will be the subject of the next video.